Last Sunday, we had two student visitors in worship from Mayor Lutheran High School. Two wonderful young people, junior and a senior at Mayor Lutheran High School. And they had made an appointment to interview me as part of their religion class assignment. And as happened 2 years ago when the religion teacher gave the assignment to their class, they came to worship and then we retreated to my office where they could ask their 12 questions. And the fellow who called me on the phone assured me that it would only take half an hour. Well, it took an hour. I don't think they'd ever met a Presbyterian before. Because I think they expected our yeses to be yeses and our noes to be noes, and they don't know that we kind of wander off sometimes. At least the people in the pulpit do. None of you ever do. Well, one of the questions that was asked was, what would you say to someone who asked, what must I do to be saved? Well, I paused, and what I said was this: you already are. You already are. So stop living so anxiously. Start living in the fullness of that abundance and that grace. Stop worrying about hell. Stop worrying about being punished. I said, you folks are your Lutherans, Missouri Synod Lutheran. You're in the Luther tradition. It was your guy who came to the moment of aha after living his life fearfully, fearing punishment, the punishment of an angry, wrathful God. And finally, he got it. That's not God. God is gracious. God is loving. God is full of grace and full of mercy. God has created us. And so live in that grace and live in the freedom for which you, as a child of God, are meant to live. So God does not make trash. And God doesn't throw good stuff away. So live in this freedom. Now that you know, start living like that. Live as a person who doesn't need to be flitting here and there and everywhere. Live less anxiously. Live more freely, more carefully, but less fearfully, less anxiously. Well, and this week at home, I know you're going to get sick and tired of these Barclay stories. Our 10-month-old Cavalier King Charles Spaniel, but Barclay has taken, he's become OCD, obsessive compulsive disorder dog, so he now sees shadows and light on the wall. He just looks around and he's just spooked by the shadows and by the light, and he's out of control. So I did a little bit of reading on the internet, and I found out that this is one of the characteristics of the Cavalier King Charles Spaniel, is that they do this. And so one of the people who commented on this website said, the question was, well, what do we do to fix it? And one of the answers was, put him on Prozac. I said, I'm not going to put my dog on Prozac. And then I read down about 10 comments down, and there is someone who says, well, here's how I handled it. They said, the first night, I decided, she said, to give him a timeout, just a 1 minute timeout. And the first night that she decided to give him the 1 minute timeout, she did it 30 times. Timeout, timeout, 30 times. The second night, it was 16. The third night, it was 9. Now, she didn't go beyond that, so I guess the dog's still freaking out about 9 times a night. So we decided to try it, see what happens. And so I just picked Barkley up very gently, and no scolding, just how do you scold a dog for being scared or being OCD? Or oppositional defiance disorder. Anyway, so I picked him up and I just put him in his kennel for 1 minute and then I brought him out. And I think probably it was about after the sixth time, okay, something like that, he calmed down. He knew we didn't want him to do that and he knew that I was in charge, sort of. But he knew he needed a master. He needed to know that he was okay, that he was secure, that whatever was causing him to go berserk on the wall, and he would go and kind of touch it or reach for it with his paw, which didn't make us real happy because those walls were newly painted. He needed somebody to take control of him in order for him to be at peace and be calm. So we've made great progress just over the last couple of days. He's much calmer, and that he knows that he's not in charge of the house. Well, what's that got to do with what do you tell a person who asks, what must I do to be saved? I'm not sure, actually. It has a lot to do with it, because if we are flitting around in our lives looking for security but not finding it, I mean, we're all, in some way, dealing with light and shadow and chasing after these shadows and these shafts of light. We're all obsessed in some way or another, aren't we? Then what must I do to be saved? Calm it down. You're not in charge. You already are. Now live like that. You don't have to control the light and the shadow on the wall. You don't have to eliminate it. You don't have to erase it. You can't. Just calm it down. In this morning's text, if your right eye causes you to sin, take it out and throw it away. And if your right hand causes you to sin, then cut it off and throw it away. For it is better for you to lose one of your members than to throw your whole body into hell. In each of these sayings of Jesus in the Beatitudes, the Sermon on the Mount, Jesus is speaking to people who very strongly believe in hell. And they also believe that some are sheep and some are goats. And those that he's talking with are pretty darn sure they're sheep. They're not goats. So they know where they're going and they know where others are going. And so it's all about perfection. Because if you're not perfect, well, you know the consequences. Jesus is cutting the rug out from that assumption. What he's doing is he's making it impossible for any person to ever get there. And what he's saying basically at the end is, you don't need to. So the right hand, if your right eye, or if your right hand is a problem, throw it away. Well, why not the left hand? Why does he talk about the right eye? Why does he talk about the right hand? Because the right hand is the hand, the dominant hand. Most of you are right-handed. If most of us were left-handed, he would talk about the left eye. This is the eye, this is the dominant eye, this is the dominant hand. It is the hand by which we control things. And we live in a culture that is about dominion, dominance, control, power. But in the gospel, God does not deal with us by the right hand of God. God deals with us with the left hand, which is the weaker hand. God surrenders power and deals with us by the left hand, the opposite of the hands that the world uses. God's power is made perfect in weakness, says St. Paul. My power is made perfect in weakness. My power is made perfect or perfected or matured in a cross. In a defeat, not in a victory. And the defeat at the hand of the right hand of the world is in fact taken up by the left hand of God for our salvation. So one of the great sermons I've ever read, I haven't read that many, but one of the great ones is by Paul Tillich. And I want to share with you Tillich's words because he says it so much better than I can. Do you know what it means to be struck by grace? It does not mean that we suddenly believe that God exists or that Jesus is the Savior or that the Bible contains the truth. To believe that something is almost contrary to the meaning of grace. Furthermore, grace does not mean simply that we are making progress in our moral self-control, in our fight against special faults, and in our relationships to others and to society. Moral progress may be a fruit of grace, a result of grace, but it is not grace itself. And it can even prevent us from receiving grace. For there is too often a graceless acceptance of Christian doctrines and a graceless battle against the structures of evil in our own personalities. Such a graceless relation to God may lead us by necessity either to arrogance, spiritual arrogance, or to despair. It would be better to refuse God and the Christ and the Bible than to accept them without grace. For if we accept without grace, we do so in the state of separation, and can only succeed in deepening the separation. Tillich talks about sin as separation, the separation of oneself from oneself, from oneself and the other, and the separation of oneself from God, the ground of all being. He says, we cannot transform our lives unless we allow them to be transformed by that stroke of grace. It happens, or it does not happen. And certainly it does not happen if we try to force it upon ourselves, just as it shall not happen so long as we think in our self-complacency that we have no need of it. Grace strikes us when we are in great pain and restlessness. It strikes us when we walk through the dark valley of a meaningless and empty life. It strikes us when we feel that our separation is deeper than usual because we have violated another life, a life that we loved or from which we were estranged. It strikes us when our disgust for our own being, or our indifference, our weakness, our hostility, our lack of direction and composure have become intolerable to us. It strikes us when year after year the longed-for perfection of life does not appear, when the old compulsions reign within us as they have for decades, when despair destroys all joy and courage. Sometimes at that moment, a wave of light breaks into our darkness, and it is as though a voice were saying, you are accepted. You are accepted. Accepted by that which is greater than you, and the name of which you do not know. Do not ask for the name now. Perhaps you will find it later. Do not try to do anything now. Perhaps later you will do much. Do not seek for anything. Do not perform anything. Do not intend anything. Simply accept the fact that you are accepted. If that happens to us, we experience grace. After such an experience, we may not be better than before, and we may not believe more than before, but everything is transformed. And in that moment, grace conquers sin, and reconciliation bridges the gulf of estrangement, and nothing is demanded of this experience. No religious or moral or intellectual presupposition, nothing but acceptance. What must I do to be saved? You already are. Accept it. In the light of grace, we perceive the power of grace in our relationships with others and ourselves. We experience the grace of being able to look frankly into the eyes of another, the miraculous grace of reunion of life with life. We experience the grace of understanding each other's words. We understand not merely the literal meaning of the words, but also that which lies behind them, even when they are harsh or angry. For even then, there is a longing to break through the walls of separation. We experience the grace of being able to accept the life of another, even if it be hostile and harmful to us. For through grace, we know that it belongs to the same ground to which we belong and by which we have been accepted. We experience the grace which is able to overcome this tragic separation of the sexes, of the generations, of the nations, of the races, and even the utter strangeness between humankind and nature itself. Sometimes grace appears in all these separations to reunite us with those to whom we belong. For life belongs to life. Sin and grace are strange words, but they're not strange things. We find them whenever we look into ourselves with searching eyes and longing hearts. When we look through the left eye to see what the right eye has seen, and when the left hand knows what the right hand is doing. Catherine of Siena, 13th century, wrote, "All has been consecrated. The creatures in the forest know this. The earth does. The seas do. The clouds know, as does the heart full of love." Strange that a priest would rob us of this knowledge and then empower himself with the ability to make holy what already was. Finally, I love old books, and there's this marvelous bookstore in Stillwater called Looms, L-O-O-M-E-S, and so I'm a Scot. I love the Church of Scotland. I love the liturgy and so forth and so on. So Kay and I are rooting around in the Looms bookstore years back now, and I see this book. That's it. It doesn't say, it's stuffed in the bookshelf. It doesn't say what it is. It's just a black leather-bound book. And I pull it out from the shelf. It's the Book of Psalms, as the Scots call them, the Psalms, the Book of Psalms and Scottish hymnal. I open it up. My name is Gordon Campbell Stewart. As I've said to some of you before, I'm a walking Civil War. But the inscription in the front of this copy, in beautiful handwriting, is John Campbell, Blair Mill, Scotland, January 20th, 1880. This is the Book of Psalms in meter and the Scottish hymnal with accompanying tunes, published for use in churches by authority of the General Assembly of the Church of Scotland. And so this book is unique in that it's divided into a top section and a lower section. The top section has do, re, mi, fa, sol, la, ti, do, and has various hymn tunes. And the lower has the psalms and paraphrases of the psalms and paraphrases of the New Testament. As I thought about this morning, I started to root around in this wonderful gem of Scottish churchmanship. And I found this paraphrase, which seems to me to fit. a paraphrase of the letter to the Hebrews, the 13th chapter. Father of peace and God of love, we own thy power to save, that power by which our shepherd rose victorious o'er the grave. Him from the dead thou broughtst again, when by his sacred blood confirmed and sealed forevermore, the eternal covenant stood. The eternal covenant stood. I will be your God, and you will be my people. Oh, may thy Spirit seal our souls and mold them to thy will, that our weak hearts no more may stray, but keep thy precepts still, that to perfection's sacred height we nearer still may rise, and all we think and all we do be pleasing in thine eyes. Amen.